Well, let's go back to June of 1920. Marionites were thrilled with the news that their Warren G. Harding, known locally as Warren or Warren G., W.G., had won the Republican nomination for President of the United States. The Beautification Committee of the Marion Civic Association was urging all of us to paint our fences and straighten up our landscaping and to put a fresh rug on our front porches. The nation was coming to town, and we needed to be ready. Well, we in Marion played host to more than 600,000 people during that three-month campaign. The twice-weekly marches from Marion's Union Station to the Harding home were led by our community bands. Harding campaign posters and banners adorned our downtown. And campaign songs like three you'll hear next became the music of Marion. Hopeful composers from all over the country, as well as regular people in many walks of life, submitted songs which they hoped would be chosen as official campaign songs by the Republican Party. As you can imagine, most of the songs were rejected. Marionites, too, participated in the call for songs. Our first selection, Harding of Marion March, was written by a well-known Marion musician, Bertram Myers, director of the Marion Civic Orchestra. Bert was a businessman in real life operating the Bert Myers Drugstore on South Prospect Street until 1949, when he and his wife moved to New Mexico. He sold the drugstore to Meister Brothers, which many of you surely remember. Bertram was an accomplished violinist, and he often played in orchestras accompanying silent movies at the Orpheum, the Original Ohio, and Marion Theaters. His Harding of Marion March was first played in Marion on July 3rd, 1920. Thank you. Warren Harding was known for his speaking ability, and he harnessed vocabulary in a wonderful way. His messages, though, were even more important. Some of his speeches, both during the campaign and his presidency, were recorded after he presented them live and made into phonograph records. Listen to these words from your president.
My countrymen, though not in any partisan sense, I must speak of the services of the men and women who rallied to the colors of the Republic in the World War. America realizes and appreciates the services rendered, the sacrifices made, and the sufferings endured. There shall be no distinction between those who knew the perils and glories of the battlefront or the dangers of the sea, and those who were compelled to serve behind the lines, or those who constituted the great reserve of a grand army which awaited the call in camps at home. All were brave, all were self-sacrificing, all were sharers of those ideals which sent our boys thrice armed to war. Worthy.
Well, the next song, Mr. Harding, We're All For You, was submitted to the National Republican Party and was enthusiastically approved. Publicity stated, the music has a swing and a pep to it, enough to bring any audience to their feet. Well, we'll let you be the judges.
From the town of Marion, Ohio, comes a man American right through. Because we know him, courageous, strong, and true. Oh, Mr. Harding, you're the man of the hour. Oh, Mr. Harding, you will soon have the power. With Calvin Coolidge, in an American way, to serve the good old USA. Nation's leader, you will very soon be, as president, we'll see you through. For you, there's only one right house, and that is the White House, Mr. Harding. We're all for you. From the good old state of Massachusetts, Calvin Coolidge comes a running mate. Steer us aboard the ship of state. Oh, Mr. Harding, you're the man of the hour. Oh, Mr. Harding, you will soon have the power. With Calvin Coolidge, in an American way, to serve the good old USA. The nation's leader, you will very soon be, as president, we'll see you through. You know the people all need you, the whole world will heed you, Mr. Harding, we're all for you.
Thank you, Dustin. Well, let's bring in some Marion County talent for the next tune. W. Reginald Carr of Caledonia, Harding's boyhood home, stepped up to the plate with Rah, Rah, Rah for Warren G. Harding.
We are going to place him there. Should our Harding take his seat on a nation's mighty throne, congratulations then would come forth from every country known. Now, people of America, give forth united prayer that we may place this loyal man in the presidential chair. Roar, roar, roar for Warren G. Harding. He's all right, our Warren G. Harding. He knows a thing or two. Vote for him and he'll help you. When he's president, our Warren G. Harding.
My countrymen, the first flaming torch of Americanism was lighted in framing the Federal Constitution in 1787. The Pilgrims signed their simple and majestic covenant a full century and a half before and set aflame their beacon of liberty on the coast of Massachusetts. Other pioneers of New World freedom were rearing their new standards of liberty from Jamestown to Plymouth for five generations before Lexington and Concord heralded the new era. It was all American in the destined results, yet all of it lacked the soul of nationality.
Well, many of us have heard about the Hollywood and Broadway stars who came to Marion to show their support for Warren Harding. Lillian Russell, Eugene O'Brien, Zenith Keith, Al Jolson, singer and dancer from Broadway, organized 60 of these famous entertainers into the Broadway Theatrical League. Jolson wrote several songs for the campaign and led his fellow entertainers in singing them from the Harding's front porch. He penned the words to the song we'll hear next.
Now that he's in, let's remind him we're behind him through thick and thin. Stick to him and help him along. Harding can't go wrong, 'cause he's from Ohio, and we're all proud of him because we know that he's a fighter and he'll fight on the square. He's honest and fair and just the man we need in the president's chair. And he's from Ohio. Wait till you see this country in a year or so. With things that don't concern him, he'll never fuss. At last we've got a man who'll look after us. We want the world to know we're all behind the man from Ohio.
Our next selection, The President Harding March, was written by Paul Crane. And yet it wasn't. Paul Crane was an alias for Carl Fenton, and Carl Fenton was an alias for Gus Henschen. Confused? Well, here's the story. Gus Henschen, and that's his real name, was a famous orchestra leader from St. Louis. He performed ragtime tunes on the piano early in his career with his drummer Theodore Schiffer. The duo recorded dozens of Victrola records in the early 1900s. He then formed the Gus Henschen Orchestra, which performed all over the country and cut many more records. When he wrote the President Harding March in late 1920, after Harding had secured a landslide election victory, he used an alias, Paul Crane. He said that sometimes more American-sounding names like Crane or Fenton, which he pulled out of the air from Fenton, Missouri, a town near St. Louis, he thought those American-sounding names sold more records, especially during and just after World War I, when Germans were not held in high esteem. Well, here's the rest of the Henschen story. He became one of the earliest conductors, arrangers, and producers of musical shows on the up-and-coming communication device, the radio. Among his radio programs in the 1930s, 40s, and 50s were the Chase and Sanborn Hour, the Maxwell House Showboat, and the Chevrolet Hour. Well, here's the President Harding March by Paul Crane or Gus Henschen. Take your pick. Just like Americans all over the country, Marionites from 1913 to 1919 were passionate about and divided over imposing prohibition in the United States. The prohibition issue made illegal the sale, manufacturing for sale, and transportation of intoxicating liquors. Well, prohibition did not make it illegal to drink, it just made it much more difficult. And there were exceptions for medicinal and religious reasons, and for beer, actually, at first. Although several of our churches frequently hosted speakers urging prohibition, you have to wonder how our dozens, and I mean dozens, of saloon operators viewed the impending demise of their income. Since many American beer brewers were of German descent, the temperance movement also cleverly tied beer production to America's enemy in World War I, the Germans. Though an unusual chain of events, the Ohio legislature voted to ratify the 18th Amendment prohibition in 1919. Well, later that year, enough states ratified the amendment, implementing prohibition throughout the nation. U.S. Senator Warren Harding, although stating that he thought alcohol consumption was an individual moral issue that could not easily be policed, voted to send the 18th Amendment to the states for ratification. His instinct that prohibition would be nearly impossible to regulate proved to be right. Just a couple of years later, when he was in the White House, he said enforcement of prohibition was one of the most difficult tasks of his administration. So let's step into the Wesley Methodist Church now at the corner of West Center Street and Olney Avenue. The 13th annual meeting of the Marion County Women's Christian Temperance Union is taking place. It's pretty crowded, so we'll sit in the back. Mrs. Viola Romans from the Ohio Temperance Union is the guest speaker. Let's listen to her for just a minute. She says, "It's been known for a long time that the Brewers and Germans were united," she said. "One of the greatest allies of Germany today for the destruction of the American people is the saloon." Wow, talk about thunderous applause. Oh, now they're handing out sheets listing different lyrics to some songs we know, the Battle Hymn of the Republic and America the Beautiful. Well, we'd better join in. You'll find the lyrics in your program.
Tramp of thousands bringing up the grand reserve, for the thickest of the onset gather faith and pluck and nerve, while old Marion County voters from our duty never swerve, for God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Marion County must be free. We have joined our hands together as we face a common foe. Noble hearts in Marion County, pray for us as forth we go. In the name of God we'll triumph and the traffic overflow, while God is marching on. Hallelujah, glory, glory, hallelujah, glory, glory, hallelujah, Marion County must be free. Then at last you'll hear the chorus from the river to the sea, chanting Marion's hallelujah from the liquor traffic free. And all hall will ring with gladness for our glorious victory, as God goes marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Marion County must be free. Let every man vote dry. stop starving children's cry, wipe tears from woman's eye, help Marion's homes.
Well, we know that Ohio ratified the Prohibition Amendment, but it was not really a cut-and-dried story. Ohio, in three elections leading up to 1919, voted down prohibition for the state. In early 1919, Ohio's General Assembly ratified the amendment for Ohio, but the people of Ohio weren't so sure. They initiated a referendum so the issue would be listed on the ballot. In November of 1919, Ohioans voted against ratification of the 18th Amendment by just 479 votes statewide. Are you curious about how Marion Countyans voted? Well, thanks to those songs, we voted for ratification by an overwhelming 62% to 38%. The pro-prohibition forces challenged the vote and asked the Ohio Supreme Court to overturn the people's vote. The Ohio Supreme Court upheld the people's vote, but the U.S. Supreme Court did not. The General Assembly's vote was deemed to be the legal one, and so Ohio ratified prohibition. Well, next we will turn our attention to 1922, when Marion celebrated its 100th anniversary. During that 100 years, Marion grew from a small settlement established by Eber Baker to a village of a couple of thousand residents. Well, by the 1890s, the village was pushing toward city status with sewers, water lines, paved roads, and sidewalks, reflecting a progressive city, as Warren Harding termed it in the pages of the Marion Daily Star. The industries that many of us knew so well, the Marion Steam Shovel Company, the Huber Manufacturing Company, American Malleable, helped Marion grow to 28,000 people by the time our hometown newspaper editor ran for president in 1920. Dick Brune, who ran the Ford dealership on Main Street and was a newcomer to town, wrote the lyrics of Good Old Marion Town, his contribution to the Marion Centennial. Local band director William Dowler wrote the music. The song apparently was an instant hit, as reported by the Star. Dick Brune has written a song, said the Star, Good Old Marion Town, that is going like hotcakes. It is in commemoration of Marion's centennial, and it has a swing to it that is calculated to rock the town. Well, of course, everybody knows that Dick Brune was never born in Marion. The rather provincial Marion Star made sure that we knew. He's a product of Arkansas, but that doesn't matter, opined Warren Harding's paper. It's the sentiment of the singer. Already 2,000 copies have been sold, 4,000 have been printed. It is not a money-making proposition, said the Star. The cover page shows Center Street on a busy day.
Marion Town. out of Marion, best town in the land. You're a source of pride with your onward stride. Keep on, grow on, expand. Great men like Harding, all owe their starting to you, old Marion town.
Oh, Marion, you are a grand old town. You are my home, sweet home. And to you I'll always be true, no matter where I roam. Sweet tender memories linger around you, you good old town, I'm so glad that I found you. I want to live and I want to die in good old Marion town.
Thank you, Dustin and Jenny. Well, the Harding presidency ended too soon. President Harding died of a heart attack on August 2, 1923, and nothing symbolized the nation's shock and sadness better than a photograph of the Hardings' Airedale looking wistfully out of a White House door, as if waiting for his master. The Associated Press on August 3 reported, "There was one member of the White House household today who could not quite comprehend the air of sadness which hung over the executive mansion. It was Laddie Boy, President Harding's Airedale friend and companion. Of late, he has been casting an expectant eye and cocking a watchful ear at the motor cars which roll up and down the White House drive. For in his dog-sense way, he seems to reason that an automobile took the Hardings away, and so an automobile must bring them back." White House attachés shook their heads and wondered how they were going to make Laddie Boy understand. Edna Bell Seward, a 46-year-old housewife in Highland Park, Illinois, was so moved by the press reports about Laddie Boy that she wrote a poem about the dog just days after the president's death. Her poem, called "Laddie Boy, He's Gone," first was published in the Chicago Evening Post. Her husband, George, a Chicago merchant, within a couple of weeks, wrote the tune.
Gone, a nation's mourning. master's face that's gone. He is smiling at you, laddie, from the peace of the beyond. But his name goes down immortal. Just the price he had to pay. Of him again. For a good laddie boy, the price of living brings sore hearts like yours today. But your master in his going points for us the best.
Although music was important to both Warren and Florence Harding, it is Florence who most closely identified with a love of music. A classically trained pianist at the Cincinnati Conservatory of Music, Florence had a vast collection of phonograph records and regularly attended concerts and operas. The famous March King, John Philip Sousa, wrote Keeping Step with the Union in 1921 when the Hardings were in the White House. Sousa dedicated to Florence Harding, and we'll follow that march with a very different song, The End of a Perfect Day, written by Kerry Jacobs Bond in 1909 to describe a sunset she viewed from a mountaintop in California. From the time she first heard it, Florence deemed it her signature song.
Thank you.
while the chimes ring out with a carol gay for the joy that the day has brought. Do you think what the end of a perfect day can mean to a time? Sun goes down with a flaming ray, and the dear friends have to part.
Well, we talked about John Philip Sousa a little while ago. Did you know he performed in Marion? On November 29, 1910, the Sousa Band, comprised of 60 performers, took the stage at the Grand Opera House on South State Street. Tickets were 50 cents, 75 cents, and $1, which equates to $13 and $20 and $27 in today's money. The concert took place not long after Sousa declared that ragtime is practically dead, to which Warren Harding's Marion star cheekily replied, which goes to show that John doesn't live next door to a man who owns a phonograph. Sousa directed the U.S. Marine Band for 12 years, from 1880 to 1892, and then formed the Sousa Band in the private sector. The band played a mix of music and finished, as always, with the Stars and Stripes Forever. Sousa wrote the song in 1896, saying it was born of homesickness when he was traveling back to America from Europe and was distraught over the recent death of his manager. The song received lukewarm responses from audiences at first, but grew in popularity during the Spanish-American War, when Americans seemed to need a patriotic tune. This is how Sousa described the experience of writing the march. "In a kind of dreamy way, I used to think over old days at Washington when I was leader of the Marine Band, when we played at all public and official functions, and I could see the Stars and Stripes flying from the flagstaff in the grounds of the White House just as plainly as if I were back there again. Then I began to think of all the countries I had visited, of the foreign people I had met, of the vast difference between America and American people and other countries and other peoples. And that flag of ours became glorified. And to my imagination, it seemed to be the biggest, grandest flag in the world, and I could not get back under it quickly enough." It was in this impatient, fretful state of mind that the inspiration to compose "The Stars and Stripes Forever" came to me, and to my imagination, it was a genuine inspiration, irresistible, complete, definite, and I could not rest until I had finished the composition. Then I experienced a wonderful sense of relief and relaxation. I was satisfied, delighted with my work after it was done. listen for the familiar trio of the piccolos. Sousa explained to the press that the three themes of the final trio were meant to typify the three sections of the United States. The broad melody, the main theme, represents the North. The South is represented by the famous piccolo obbligato, and the West by the bold counter-melody of the trombones. In 1987, Congress designated Stars and Stripes Forever as the nation's official march. It was Sousa's encore piece at his band shows, and it was in March in Marion in 1910. Thank you. Well, we want to give a special nod to the talented musicians and vocalists who brought Marion's music to life tonight. Merrill Cooper Bender, Jenny Collins Evans, Jenny Collins Evans, Gary Imes, come on out, Gary. Dustin Rollins, Louise Vance, and of course the Marion Concert Band under the direction of Bill Swihart. For your information, and Bill asked me to mention this, the Marion Concert Band has its spring concert right here, Sunday, April 29th at 3 p.m. Admission is free, and we hope to see you back here on Sunday the 29th at 3 p.m. Thank you for your wonderful performances. Well, our program this evening was sponsored by several generous businesses, foundations, and educational institutions. Please join me in thanking Kevin Lehman of Lehman Capital Management Group, Dan Wigton of Stifel Financial Services, Marion Technical College, Ohio Health, River Valley Local Schools for their wonderful facility, the Ohio State University at Marion, along with Marion County Historical Society and the Harding Home and Presidential Site. Thank you all to all of our sponsors. Many hours of planning and preparation were required by several individuals who joined together to organize and implement tonight's event. Please show your appreciation to Rick Baird, Merrill Cooper Bender, Sherry Hall, Gary Imes, Brian Jester, Brandy Wilson, and Randy Windland. And finally, if you haven't already done so, remember to order your CDs or DVDs on your way out. Return envelopes are also available if you wish to mail in your order. Good night, and thank you very much for attending.